Last time on Mario and Luigi Retrospective, we look at the first outing from this Super Mario role-playing spin-off, Superstar Saga, that proved to be not only universally loved, but successful enough to warrant more games that were released in tandem with the sibling spin-off Paper Mario. Let's take a look at the first foray in the double screen with Mario and Luigi, Partners in Time.
With Hiroyuki Kubota counting in the helm, this game came out in 2005 at the coattails of Superstar Saga and Paper Mario's critical high point, the Thousand Year Door, so it already had large boots to fill. At this point, the series was still looking for its footing and tried to alter its mechanics and gameplay structure, among other things, and because of that, some people consider it to be a lesser entry. Those people include me, but I shall eventually show why that is.
Speaking of showing, once again the gameplay material is crudely shot by pointing the camera at Nintendo 3DS and altering between its two screens, because those capture cards ain't cheap, yo. Well, I could have gone for a that cheaper option and buy the console's newest model, because it has streaming capabilities, but come on. Who buys a brand new Nintendo 3DS in 2020?
Few years back, deep in space, an extraterrestrial race of shroobs are looking for a new home, and Mushroom Kingdom seems just the right place. The right place to invade, that is! Meanwhile, in the present, Princess Peach and her entourage are going to travel to the past with the time machine invented by Professor E. Gadd of Luigi's Mansion fame. And because the present Mushroom Castle seems to be in good condition, it's safe to assume that whatever Shroobs tried in the past didn't luckily pan out. I think. Yeah, I have a feeling this game doesn't care about establishing any rules for its time travel shenanigans.
Partners in Time doesn't really take advantage of the fact that it's a time travel story. All it really amounts to is the past and the present versions of established characters engaging in high-quality slapstick.
Predictably, something goes horribly wrong, so the Plumber Bros have to travel back in time in order to save the princess from the alien scum. In the past, the group have been busy laying waste on peace-loving communities, starting with the Christmas village. The mood is unusually dark for a Mario game, perhaps too dark. Compared to the atrocities done by villains before and after, Shroobs, led by one mean daughter of a female canine princess Shroob, have the most heinous ones, ranging from sucking life energy out of people in order to use it as fuel for the space fleet, to generally being nasty, mean-spirited assholes with no humoristic quirks. Whoa. Welp, time to switch to democracy, I guess.
At the time of the game's release, I couldn't stand Shroobs because I thought them to be ill-fitting for the franchise. Over the years, my stance has so unsoftened, for I've heard that Paper Mario has even more messed up stuff in it, but yeah, Shroobs are too effective of a threat that would suck the joy out completely if it wasn't for the before-mentioned strong slapstick routines.
Speaking of which, soon Mario and Luigi meet themselves as babies, thus getting all the player characters together to search for the source of the time machine's power source Cobalt Star that may or may not aid in thwarting the Purple Menace. From there, the plot continues in almost straightforward path that has few good dramatic moments, but its progression feels loosely written. This is demonstrated by the journalist Kylie Cooper, who is unrealistically aware of where Shroobs are hiding and what their plans are, just because, the game needs someone to tell the player what is going on. Linearity is also reflected in the gameplay structure, as in a controversial design choice, instead of the sprawling world maps of the previous and future games, the present Princess Peach's castle works as a hub world connecting to the past places as if they were separate levels.
In theory, there's nothing wrong with that, but part of Superstar Saga's appeal were those block paths that you needed to return to after learning the right special moves, and this game is completely missing that aspect. Sure, there's like one area where there are item blocks that you can reach with your current skill set, but that's not really enough for me to bother to return back.
Then there's the combat system that is mostly the same but is crippled down by two factors. Firstly, adding babies makes the battle super easy by accident, because even if one of the adults gets knocked out, their baby version can use a one-up and bring them back to field before the enemy has time to do any damage to them. Secondly, bro moves and bro points have been ditched in favor of consumable battle items, and I honestly don't understand why they did it this way. I guess they wanted to prevent players from spamming the strongest attacks by making them a limited resource, but that theory doesn't make sense either, because these items are offered like free candy. Also, when the special battle moves can be bought from any random shop, it takes the meaning out of acquiring them.
Even still, the battles can be fairly entertaining, and the bosses have more puzzle elements in them to spice things up. But I feel the developers approached this from the wrong angle. Mario & Luigi Partners in Time certainly has the needed quality requirements of its publisher firm's catalog, but it's easy to see why this didn't receive a 3DS remake.
It can't be denied that the game has charm. The sprites are just as lively, the music is just as ear-cuddling, and even though I didn't like the darkness-infused atmosphere and undercooked narrative, this story is as event-rich as before. What drifts this game towards the meh category though are its linearized game mechanics, both in and out of combat, that take away too much without exchanging anything proper in return. To summarize, it's only slightly above average experience that evidently suffered from the shorter than usual development cycle.
I think the developers were aware of this as well, because it would take a longer while before the next installment, Bowser's Inside Story, would come out. Therefore, I shall take a longer break from Mario & Luigi stuff as well, and wonder how I'm going to film that next episode. In the next one, however, we shall follow a man who not only swims in darkness, he also embraces it. Until then, thanks for your time.